I'm Rhonda Sherman, and I was at North Carolina State University for 30 years teaching vermicomposting and composting.
Well, I'm so excited to talk to you today. I did a lot of online researching and your name popped up just about everywhere when looking up vermicomposting. So I was wondering if you could first just tell us, how did you get into this work? And it sounds like this has become a passion of yours.
It totally
what
is.
Do you enjoy? What do you enjoy about it?
Yes, I have had a strong passion for keeping things out of the landfill for the past 43 years. And so my profession has involved over all that time. It's been reduce, reuse, recycle, compost, and vermicompost. A lot of states have banned yard waste from landfills, but most have been very slow to do anything about food waste. And I consider food waste to be the most dangerous thing, pretty much, you know, besides, you know, really toxic chemicals. But out of the basic things that go into the landfill, food waste I consider to be the worst because it creates methane. And if, you know, I encourage your students to look it up on the EPA's website, but it's well documented that where they talk about climate change and the effects of what is producing the most methane and landfills are right up there. And it's only because of organic materials. It's not plastic. It's not, you know, so it's food waste.
When I was initially doing my research, I was like, well, this methane is being produced by bacteria that are breaking down the food, which those bacteria also exist in compost. So like, why isn't methane being produced there too? And from my understanding, it sounds like it's aerobic by rotating the compost. Is that correct?
Yes. So composting is supposed to be an aerobic process, and it pretty much is. So you'll get a little bit of carbon dioxide that comes out of a compost pile, but hardly any methane whatsoever. Whereas landfills are designed to keep out air and keep out sunlight and keep out rain. And so everything is, so you're entombing food waste. And so it's rotting very slowly in the absence of air. And that produces methane.
Well, so to move to vermicomposting and vermicast in particular, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how it helps the soil and how it's helpful to plants specifically.
Yes. In my book, The Worm Farmer's Handbook, I have a section where I list 17 ways that vermicompost is helpful to soil. So I'll just briefly mention some, but it's adding organic matter to the soil and beneficial microorganisms. And it helps the soil to absorb and retain water next to the plant roots where the water is really needed.
From your book, I learned and was so fascinated by this idea that every vermicast, which is the product of vermicomposting, is different. And it's like this idea of what goes in will come out. And obviously, it's a lot more complicated than that since there are many variables at play, like different organisms and environmental factors. But at the same time, I found it so interesting that you really could see a big difference between two different types of vermicast.
You know, a lot of people, they just think it's all the same, you know, because we're used to thinking of fertilizer. Well, fertilizer is manufactured. And so it can be controlled. The inputs are controlled. So we always know what the output is going to be, you know, for that particular recipe for specific fertilizers. And so people tend to think that all vermicast is alike, you know, but right. There have been studies, so many research studies. It's really fun to go to Google Scholar and just type in vermicast effects on plants. And you just see, you know, just tens of thousands of studies. And so a lot of them will compare, you know, like they'll compare vermicast from when the worms were fed cow manure, and then vermicast from when the worms were fed food waste or paper waste or pig manure. And you'll see that you come up, you know, you've got different nutrients, you've got different microorganisms, you know, things are quite different between them. And then they have different effects on plants. And that is, you know, that takes a lot of study to figure it out. So it's just looking at inputs. What do the worms consume? And then what comes out the other end is going to be different.
How quickly might you see changes?
So the worms are excreting the material and it always accumulates on the bottom of the bin. And so within 4 to 6 months, you'll want to remove that vermicast from the bin, but it's ready before then. It's a very different process than composting, where an animal, the worm, is actually consuming the microbes and little bits of particles of organic material. And then it's passing through that animal and coming out the other end. So it's finished. You can use it right away. You know, it'll look like soil in the bottom. And those are the castings from the worms. And it is on the bottom, so it's not always, you know, it's not easy to get to, depending on what kind of system you have. And so, you know, and you don't want to be harvesting weekly, you know, that's kind of a lot of work.
Okay. And so the idea of like not harvesting weekly is less about that it's not possible, but more it's just, it's not, like, it doesn't really make sense in terms of the amount of time.
Yeah. Because then, you know, again, depending on what type of worm bin you have, you know, if it's a continuous flow through worm bin where you can remove, you know, it can come out the bottom, you could harvest more often. But if you just have, I call it a mono bin, you know, just one, you know, like a plastic tub in the classroom, that would be too much disruption to the worms and too much work. And there wouldn't be that much after a week, you know.
Mm-hmm. So you mentioned that there are a lot of different variables going on beyond just this idea of balance of carbon and nitrogen. But I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about that, because it seems like it's very important.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, the thing is, nitrogenous materials, and that would include food waste and animal manures, you know, that are stinky. The animal manure we know is stinky. We smell it, right? And food waste, as it rots, it releases a very stinky odor. And so it's really important to balance that out with a carbonaceous material, what we refer to as browns, you know, but it kind of absorbs those odors and juices of decomposition. And it also adds more space, because nitrogenous material is wet and dense. So it compacts. And then it's just the stinky blob. But if you mix in the browns, then you're allowing air passages to come through. That's very helpful. Yeah.
That makes a lot of sense. Something that I was a little confused by is when I was thinking through, because I've been thinking about this idea of cycling of matter and thinking about, you know, my carbohydrates, my proteins, my fats. When I think of carbohydrates, which would be primarily in fruits and vegetables, and I think of those being having huge amounts of carbon. And so I was just wondering, like, where am I misunderstanding things?
So the carbon to nitrogen ratio of food waste in general, you know, because we know it's all very different, right? But in general, it's 20 to 1. So when you have the carbon to nitrogen ratio, you have carbon and then a colon, and then nitrogen is always 1. And so the lower the carbon number means the higher the nitrogen number.
Okay.
And 20 to 1 is not that high. You know, you look at newspaper, that's like, you know, 700 to 1.
Okay.
So food waste is considered lower. And then you get into animal manures, and that can be as low as, you know, it can be 12 to 1 or even as low as 6 to 1.
So let's say we're in a classroom and we followed your great, you have a great video that talks about how to set up a worm bin, like we can get started. From there, like in terms of a class, like how often would you recommend checking on it? Is that something you check on daily, weekly, monthly?
I would check it daily. Yeah, it's important. You know, you don't want to disturb the worms. So you don't want to go in there daily and start digging around. You know, you want to respect their environment. But you just want to open it up. You want to take the lid off. And first thing, notice if you can see any worms, okay? Because the worms, if you have a healthy worm bin, you shouldn't be able to see any worms when you take the lid off. If you see just a few worms, maybe up to 6 at the most, just gliding around, they're just exploring, that's okay. But if you see a bunch of worms, they're trying to get out, and it's because there's a problem in the worm bin. And that's why my publication, Worms Can Recycle Your Garbage, has a troubleshooting guide that, you know, you can look at it and say, oh, you know, I open this up and it smells. It shouldn't smell. There should be no odor, or it should smell kind of earthy, but that's it. Mm-hmm. Earthy as in like a forest. So
right.
There should not be any bad odors. Most often people end up with too wet of a bin, and then you've got a bun, you know, you've got moisture in the bottom and air can't get through the moisture. And so it gets stinky.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't want that. And when you overfeed, that's the number one problem with worm bins, and it can cause a lot of problems. So you definitely should check every day just to make sure the worms are alive and thriving.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's good to know. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you so much for sharing your expertise. Really.
Sure.
We really appreciate it.
Yeah, I'm very happy to do it.